Hello friends, welcome to my YouTube channel Know Your Law. Let us have a discussion today on the law relating to custodial violence and custodial deaths in India, and let us also look at some of the very significant decisions of the Supreme Court of India on the issue of custodial violence, and also let us look at the obligations that we as a country have to the international community under the international law with respect to prevention of torture to our citizens by the state authorities. Now, in India, we do not have a standalone or a comprehensive legislation that specifically deals with the issue of custodial violence. However, there is a bill called the Protection of Torture Bill, which was introduced in the year 2011 in the Parliament, which has not yet completed the process of lawmaking. For it to become an act so that the domestic courts in India could enforce the provisions of the act. So the major provisions relating to custodial violence are contained under the Criminal Procedure Code, the Indian Evidence Act, and the Indian Penal Code. So before we discuss the issue of custodial violence, it is very important to understand the term custody. Now, a person is said to be in the custody of a police officer when the police officer apprehends a person and takes physical control over the body of the suspected offender. Now, in general terms, when the police receive information regarding commission of an offense in their jurisdiction, they have all the authority and obligation under the law to ensure that the crime is prevented from commission if the crime has not yet been committed, and if the crime has already been committed, they have the authority to investigate the matter and take all the necessary steps, including the arrest of the suspected offender. Now, the moment a police officer takes any suspected offender into his custody, the police officer is under an obligation under the law to ensure that certain rights are made available to the arrested person. So these rights are broadly mentioned under the Criminal Procedure Code, the Indian Evidence Act, and the Indian Penal Code. So Section 54 of the Criminal Procedure Code gives a right to the accused person who has been arrested by a police officer to get himself medically examined by a recognized medical practitioner. Now, this right has been given to the arrested person to ensure that the police has not used a disproportionate or unwarranted force in order to make the arrest of that person. So this provision is a safeguard given to the arrested person against the brutal force which the police may use in certain circumstances to make arrest of a person. Now, Section 164 of the Criminal Procedure Code says that the statements given by the complainant or the accused persons or witnesses, maybe for that matter, before a police officer will not have any value unless such statements are made again by the accused persons before the court under Section 164 of the Criminal Procedure Code. Now, for the sake of clarity, let me explain the provisions of 161 and 164 of the code. So, during the process of investigating a crime, a police officer has all the authority to get formal written statements by the accused and by the complainant, and also by witnesses if there are any. Now, these statements are given to the police under Section 161, which empowers the police to take statements from the accused. Now, Section 164 talks about statements which may be recorded before the magistrate in relation to commission of that crime when the case goes to trial. Now, Sections 164 and 161 are inserted in the code to safeguard the accused persons from making confessions before the police under force. Section 25 and 26 of the Indian Evidence Act clearly says that statements or confessions made by the suspected offenders before the police are not in themselves sufficient to convict a person. In other terms, statements or confessions made by the accused persons before the police do not have any evidentiary value when a case goes for trial before a magistrate. Sections 330 and 331 of the Indian Penal Code talks about punishments which may be imposed by the courts on the police officers who use unnecessary force against the offenders to get confessions from them. Now, because of the absence of any specific legislation that recognizes the right of citizens against torture by state authorities, the Supreme Court has read this right into Article 21 of the Constitution that talks about life and personal liberty. So, in one of the major decisions by the Supreme Court in D.K. Basu versus State of West Bengal, the Supreme Court has discussed in detail the procedure to be followed by the police while making arrest and the right of the accused persons which is available to them right from the time of arrest until the arrested person remains in the custody of the police. The background of this case is that the chairman of the Legal Services Authority of the state of West Bengal had written a letter to the Chief Justice of India regarding various mysterious deaths that were happening across various prisons in West Bengal. So the Supreme Court treated this letter as a public interest litigation and has discussed various procedures to be followed by the police when they make arrest. In the case of Nandini Satpathy versus P.L. Dani, decided by the Supreme Court in 1978, the Supreme Court has discussed in detail the right against self-incrimination and various constitutional provisions in relation to it. Now, the basic background of this case is that Nandini Satpathy was a former Chief Minister of Orissa, and an FIR was lodged against her on under the Prevention of Corruption Act on the grounds that she had acquired disproportionate assets during the tenure when she served as the Chief Minister of Orissa. Now, during the process of investigation, a questionnaire was given to her by the investigation officer, and the accused Nandini refused to answer some of the questions in the questionnaire on the ground that those questions were self-incriminatory in nature. So, the Supreme Court in this case has discussed in detail the right against self-incrimination, and in addition to this, it has also held that psychological torture by the police and tiring investigation by the investigating officer are not permissible under law and are in violation of the law on the ground that they amount to torture. In Sunil Batra versus Delhi administration, the Supreme Court in 1978 has laid down broad guidelines for prison reforms and has discussed in detail about the rights of prisoners. The basic background of this case is that the accused Sunil Batra was serving a life sentence in Tihar jail, and during his life sentence he wrote a letter to the Chief Justice of India about an incident which had occurred in the jail, wherein a warden of a jail used to harass another inmate with an intention to extort money from the relatives who used to come to the jail to visit him. So the Supreme Court in this case has given broad guidelines for prison reforms and has also held that although there are no specific provisions under the Constitution or any other law regarding prison reforms, the court has wide authority under Article 14 and Article 21 of the Constitution of India to protect the inmates of prisons from torture by state authorities. Rakhbir Singh versus State of Haryana, decided by the Supreme Court in 1980, wherein the background of the case is that the accused Rakhbir Singh was accused of committing theft, and the police had used excessive force which resulted in the death of the accused. So the Supreme Court came down heavily against the police officers who were involved in this case and observed that the police are expected to protect the rights of the citizens and not misuse their authority and torture the accused persons who are in their custody. And also in this case, the Supreme Court awarded a life sentence for the police officer or the and the investigating officer who were responsible for the death of Ragbir Singh. In Prakash Singh versus Union of India, decided by the Supreme Court in the year 2008, a petition was filed by a retired IPS officer, Mr. Prakash Singh, seeking for guidelines from the Supreme Court for police reforms. So the Supreme Court in this case went on to issue numerous guidelines for reforms within the police department and to sensitize the police with respect to many sensitive matters in the society, including custodial deaths and custodial rapes. And one of the major guidelines which was issued by the Supreme Court, which is relevant to the topic that we are discussing today, is the setting up of police complaints authority at every district and in every state. So although the direction was issued by the Supreme Court way back in 2006, not many states have established the police complaint authority yet. So this is one of the major decisions of the Supreme Court in seeking to curtail instances of torture by the police. So let us also have a look at various steps that are being taken by many sovereign nations across the world with an intention to protect their citizens from custodial violence and torture. So the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights both talk about right to dignified treatment by the state authorities and right against custodial violence. So Article 7 of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights declares that a right against torture and cruelty is a fundamental right available to every person who is in the custody of a state authority. And this article also declares that the states cannot violate this right of the citizens even in situations of public emergency. Now, another significant step of the international community with respect to prevention of torture is the adoption of a United Nations resolution against torture, which was passed in the year 1984 by the United Nations, and many democratic nations including India are signatories to this convention against torture. And India being a signatory to this convention has not yet ratified this convention by enacting a domestic legislation. So India became a party to this resolution in the year 1987, and it has been more than 23 years and India has not yet enacted domestic legislation so that the provisions of the convention can be enforced in India. Now, with an intention to ratify the convention against torture, the government introduced the bill called Prevention of Torture Bill in Lok Sabha in 2010, but the bill has only been passed in Lok Sabha and it has been stuck in Rajya Sabha since 2010. It is with the select committee of the Rajya Sabha and they are making deliberations on the bill, and they are also working on widening the definition of torture. At present, the bill defines torture as any act committed by the state authority with an intention to get a confession from the accused person or with an intention to derive some information in relation to a crime. Another important fact that has to be noted here is there is something called as a periodical review of the record of human rights, which is conducted by the United Nations General Assembly in Geneva. So what happens here is generally every state party to the convention against torture sends its senior most law officers. The attorney general of the Supreme Court usually attends this periodical review, which is undertaken by the UN every once or twice 2 years, and the United Nations takes stock of the compliance of state parties with respect to enacting a domestic law to enforce the provisions relating to prevention of torture. Now, since 2000, we have been making representations to the United Nations, and every time we go to the UN, we give some or the other kind of excuse for not having a domestic law. So every major democratic nation in this world has long ratified this convention, and India is far behind even having a discussion in the parliament with respect to prevention of torture. So this is something which has to be taken up by the parliament immediately in order to gain respect of the international community. Now, another major institution that has a vital role to play when it comes to prevention of torture is the Human Rights Commission, which is established under the Protection of Human Rights Act of 1993. So, as soon as this commission was established, this commission recognized custodial violence and custodial deaths as an area of priority. And the commission has also issued various guidelines for the police authorities to adhere to. And the guidelines also say that whenever there is a custodial death in any state, it has to be reported to the Human Rights Commission within 24 hours. And also in cases of custodial death, a post-mortem report and a complete videograph of the post-mortem has to be sent to the commission.